Welcome to a video on the Squeeze Theorem and Special Limits. Hopefully we can get through all this in 10 minutes or less. The Squeeze Theorem states that if h of x is less than or equal to f of x less than or equal to g of x, for all x in an open interval containing c, except possibly at c itself, and if the limit as x approaches c of h of x is equal to l, which is equal to the limit as x approaches c of g of x, so if both of these limits are equal to l, then the limit as x approaches c of f of x must also equal l. So graphically, what's happening here is that if we have h of x here and g of x here, where f of x is squeezed or sandwiched in between these two functions, then in this case, if the limit of h and g as x approaches 1 is equal to 2, we could also conclude that the limit as x approaches 1 of f of x is also equal to 2. Let's consider the limit as x approaches 0 of sine x divided by x and see if we can figure out what this is equal to using the squeeze theorem. So here's the setup. We're going to compare the area of this large triangle to this sector and to this smaller triangle, where angle theta is on the unit circle. Therefore, this length is equal to 1, and this length would also equal 1. This segment here would be the tangent segment for this angle. Therefore, this would be the height of this first triangle. Remember, the area is equal to 1/2 base times height. Well, 1/2 times 1 times tangent theta would give us tangent theta divided by 2. So that would be the area for this larger triangle here. Now let's see if we can figure out the area for this sector here, and then lastly for this smaller triangle here. The area of a sector is 1/2 r theta. Well, since r is 1, we have 1/2 theta, or theta divided by 2. Lastly, on the small triangle here, this point here is on the unit circle, so the y-coordinate would be equal to sine theta, so the area would be 1/2 times 1 times sine theta, or sine theta divided by 2. Geometrically, we can see that the area of this sector is between the area of this larger triangle and this smaller triangle. Next, what we're going to do is multiply every term here by 2 divided by sine theta. Notice I also changed tangent theta into sine theta divided by cosine theta. Now, when we simplify, the result is 1 over cosine theta greater than or equal to theta divided by sine theta, which is greater than or equal to 1. Let's go ahead and take this result onto the next screen. Next, we'll take the reciprocal of each of these terms. So we'd have cosine theta over 1. Here we'd have sine theta divided by theta. And of course, the reciprocal of 1 is equal to 1. Now there's one catch here. If we take the reciprocals of these, then we'd have to reverse the inequality symbols. So now we would have less than or equal to in both cases. Hopefully that makes sense, because if you compare 1/2 and 1/3, for example, we know 1/2 is larger than 1/3, but if you take the reciprocals, you'd have 2 and then 3. To maintain a true statement, you'd have to reverse the inequality symbol there. Now what we're going to do is take the limit of cosine theta and the limit of 1 as theta approaches 0. Well, this limit would be equal to 1. This isn't even affected by theta, so this is equal to 1. So limit of this is equal to 1, limit of this is equal to 1. We can conclude using the squeeze theorem that the limit as theta approaches 0 of sine theta divided by theta must also equal 1. Okay, there's two other special limits we want to discuss briefly. We won't prove them, but we'll verify them. So here's the first one we just discussed. Next, the limit as x approaches 0 of 1 minus cosine x divided by x is equal to 0. And then lastly, the limit as x approaches 0 of 1 plus x raised to the power of 1 divided by x is equal to Euler's number, or e. Let's go ahead and take a look at the second special limit now. We're not going to prove it, but we'll go ahead and see if we can verify it. Remember, there are three methods to determine a limit. One of them is numerically, another one is graphically. Let's take a look at the graph first. One problem with using graphing technology is it doesn't always graph the functions accurately. We know that this would be undefined at x equals 0, so there's actually a hole right here. However, we can see that as we approach from the right and the left, we can see that the function value is approaching zero, which is the value of this special limit. Another way would be to look at the values of the function as x approaches zero here in the middle. So let's go ahead and take a moment and do that. Let's compare the value of the function as x approaches zero. So we'll type in our function into y1. Let's go to our table set and change the independent variable to ask. Go to our table and we'll just type in these values. So you can see as we're approaching zero from the left, these are the function values. Let's go ahead and record those. And from the right, we're going to have the same values, just different signs. So here we have positive 0.05, positive 0.005, and you can see that this is approaching zero. So we'll go ahead and accept this second special limit. The last limit we want to look at is this one. Again, if you take a look at the graph, you can see that this function would be undefined at x equals zero, so there would be a hole here. But we still can't approach from the left and the right, so this limit is going to exist. You can see it's approaching a value that's less than 3. Remember, e is approximately 2.718. And let's go ahead and verify this with our table as well. So we'll go back and change our function. So y1, we have our function. Let's go to our table. And you can see from the last values we have, let's go ahead and put in the positive values as well, that as x approaches 0, it does look like it's approaching 2.718, or e. So we'll go ahead and accept this special limit as well. Again, these are not proofs, but this is a nice verification of the special limit. The next video, we'll talk about how to find other limits using these special limits. Thank you for watching.